Hi there YouTube, and welcome to this multi-part guide to the configuration options of the FragTrade trading bot. In this video I will be going through the configuration parameters for the generic bot and exchange settings. But before I continue, first a warning. This is edutainment and I'm not responsible for faulty setups and possible losses of money as a result of these setups. Please do your own research on the configuration options, and the FragTrade website is an excellent source for it. Always do a dry run of at least a month to test your settings and to get a feeling of how the bot behaves. Only when you have an absolute confidence in your bot's configuration, you should use the configuration. I'm not affiliated with FragTrade or its developers, and all information you will see in this video is my own interpretation of the documentation and my personal experience of the FragTrade bot. And now let's get this out of the way and continue. In this video I will start with the multiple generic settings that you can use to configure your bot. And after that I'll end with parameters you can set to configure your exchange. This video is a follow-up on my previous video where I gave an introduction to the configuration file of FragTrade. And again, I'm using the virtual machine from earlier videos. It's a Linux virtual machine with Mint as my distribution. If you want more information about the configuration options, I recommend you to visit the FragTrade website and read the content and especially the configuration page for this video. First of all, I'm going to explain some global configuration parameters. These parameters only give FragTrade its instruction on how to behave on your system and where to look for files and such. So, after you have created a new configuration file with the FragTrade command new config, the generic bot settings will be at the end of the file. The FragTrade development team apparently thought that it was best to place this section at the end, so it's not my decision. As you can see in the picture, the initial settings only configure the most necessary options like the bot's name, the state of the bot after starting, and some process settings that determine how much resources the bot will use in your computer. So let's see which parameters are there to configure the bot, and before I forget, there's no specific order in which you have to set these parameters, so let's just continue. The parameter we begin this discussion with is the bot's name. The bot's name obviously gives the name to the bot, of course. This name can be called whatever you want, and if you connect with an API to the bot, it shows its name. You can also distinguish multiple bots from each other on the same server this way, so if you look at syslog events from servers with multiple bots, you see those different names appear in the log file. After that, the initial state option determines if the bot's application state is stopped or start after you turn on the bot. It's a little bit difficult to understand, but when you start the bot on the command line, this configuration is going to determine if the bot is actually doing something or not. It can be in a running or a stopped state. So with this initial state option, you can start the bot, but you also can directly tell it to just wait until you give it a real starting signal to trade. And after that, then the bot is going to trade for you. For example, if you want to start the bot on the server and if you set it to the initial stopped state, then it waits for a signal from you to just actually do start trading. And these signals can be given by API or by Telegram, for example. I always leave the default state at running, so I know that if I start a bot, I actually am starting the bot and not leaving it in a stopped state. The last parameter on this page is the process throttle. It determines how much the FragTrade process will consume power from your computer. If you set this to 1 second, the bot will consume more CPU power and therefore has a higher load on your computer. However, if you set the bot to a lower frequency, the load on your computer might be lower from the bot, but the bot will be also less responsive and other software processes could get a higher priority on your computer. I've not changed this setting, so I have no problems with it, but if you have a Raspberry Pi, for example, and you have a lot of processes running on the Pi, you can give the bot a little bit lesser priority, so it will consume less CPU power. Otherwise, just leave it as it is. The parameters on this page concern the logging of the bot's messages and the heartbeat. With the first parameter, you tell the bot that it should give a I'm still here message to your screen or to your log file. This way you know that the bot is still working and did not crash without any notification. Normally it sends a heartbeat every 60 seconds, but if you want to see more confirmation on the bot's behavior and working, you can give it a shorter time frame. You only use the SDNotify parameter if you have a Linux distribution which uses the systemd as its journaling system. This also needs to have the Python systemd package installed as a dependency. And if you do not use the systemd or journald in your distribution, then FragTrade just will use the syslog system on your Linux or Windows. The last option you can use is to send all the FragTrade messages to a specific log file for FragTrade alone. This way you can split all FragTrade messages from the other file system messages, which makes troubleshooting FragTrade a little bit easier. In previous videos, I used the strategy parameter on the command line to give FragTrade instructions to use a special strategy. But you can also set the strategy in the configuration file itself. The first parameter is using that one. You also have to give FragTrade the strategy path, so it can look for the strategy and that path, otherwise it doesn't know where to look. With the user data directory option, you can specify another directory where you placed your user data. Normally, this directory is within the FragTrade bot directory structure. However, if you also use a directory outside of the structure for security or management reasons, you can also use this option to say to FragTrade it has to look for user files in another place. You can also use this option if you want to use multiple bots on the same server, but do not want to integrate all their data and databases in one single directory. The DB URL option can be used if you want to give your trading database another name than the default FragTrade database name. This can be convenient when you use multiple bots and you want to give each bot a specific database instance and also its own name. If that's not a problem, then you don't use this option. The data format, open, high, low, close and volume, and trades parameter can be used if you really have to use another format for storing this information. However, if that's not the case, then I see not much added value in changing these parameters. The force by enable option, which is set to false by the way, is an option you can use if you want to enable to execute buy orders via Telegram or REST API by hand, even though the strategy does not say it should buy the pair. If you bought a pair by using this option though, the bot will keep the pair until a manual or a strategy sell order has been ordered. I personally can imagine that you want to use this option to buy the dip. But before you use this option, you have to be absolutely sure that the dip is a dip within a bullish trend and not the start of a bear trend, otherwise you could lose a lot of money with this option. And with this last parameter, it's time to see them in practice. In this demonstration, we are going to make a new configuration file for the FragTrade bot, and we are going to add some bot-specific configuration options at the end and see what they will do to the bot. Let's go ahead. You can see that I already am in my FragTrade directory and I have started up the Python virtual environment. The command to create a new configuration file is this, FragTrade new config, and then specify the configuration name. And let's just enter this in the terminal window. And you will see that FragTrade will ask us a few questions. And we just take the default settings. This one, because we're going to edit the configuration file at the end. Okay, configuration file has been made. Now let's move on. You can open the configuration file with your favorite command line editor. In my case, it's Nano. I'm not a big VI fan because it's too hard to learn for me. I'm a little bit lazy, but let's continue. Okay. Now you will see here, this is the configuration file. And as I said earlier, the bot-specific configurations are at the end. Now that the configuration file has been made, let's find out what will happen if we just start FragTrade with this just made configuration file and see what will happen. Oh. I already have prepared a file with all the configurations and commands I want to use for this demonstration, so it's just a matter of copying and pasting. In this case, I'm going to copy the command to start FragTrade with the config file we just made with this strategy. And let's just paste it and see what will be the response of the bot. And he's a little bit slow. No worries. Here it comes. You can see over here that in the bottom it uses the CCXT library. Oh, it's already gone. Connected to Binance, you can see also that the volume pair list method has been used for determining which pairs you want to trade. You can see these are the 20 pairs that apparently has the most volume at this moment. The bot is running, and you see RPC information. And finally, there is a heartbeat for the bot. So yeah, everything seems to work fine at this moment. That's great. Let's close it and edit the config file. The first thing we are going to configure are these three lines. That is the change of the bot name, the initial state. Here is running, but I'm going to change it to stopped in the configuration file, and the force by enable equals true. So let's begin. And let's go all the way down. And you can see over here that the name is FragTrade at the moment. Well, I'm going to change it to any name I want. Let's change to MoneyMaker. Seems cool to me. And the running will be changed into stopped. So you can see what's happening if I restart the bot. And this way, and force by enable has been set to true. For force by enable, we have to configure RPC or a Telegram bot to send the bot a message to buy a certain pair. I'm not going to do that. It's more like an indicator that it's possible and it doesn't stop the bot or whatever. Let's save it, exit, and let's see what's happening if I just start the bot with this configuration. The funny thing is that the bot name MoneyMaker is not appearing here in the startup of the bot in the terminal window. But if we are looking into the syslog files, then you will see that syslog is logging messages from this bot with the name MoneyMaker, and maybe I'm going to show that later. The most important thing to note here is that we changed the initial status of running to stopped, and you can see over here that the bot is running, but the state has been set to stopped, so it's not actually doing something, but it will do something if we send the bot the command from RPC or from Telegram to start trading. So that's a big difference. And if you set it like this but forget that it's it has a state of stopped, then it doesn't do anything, and you will not be trading, of course. Okay, now we have set these three lines. It's time to move on and configure this one. Let's open the configuration file again and move to the end of the file. Okay, first of all, I'm going to change it again to running, because otherwise the bot will be stopped if I start it. That's strange as yet, but you know the point I'm trying to make. Okay, we can leave this true, and I'm just copying and paste these lines into my configuration file. Okay, here you can see that I'm pointing the FragTrade bot to the user data directory, which is actually within the FragTrade directory itself, but it's just more specific this way. And you can also see that the strategy path is also the same directory. This is also the default directory for strategy, but you can change this to another directory where you can save all your strategies which you have found out or just experimenting with. Also, I'm going to change or add this line, so you can see that I don't have to give a sample strategy, the command line, the strategy file, but it just reads it from this set of lines and it will start the bot without any question. So what I'm going to do is here, just remove this one. And from this moment, the configuration file has all the specific needs for the bot to work. Here, this is Binance. Here you see the RPC messages, the pairs again. And if we just wait a second, then you will see that it's also has the strategy from this directory. Let's see, I cannot find it at the moment. Here you are. This is a sample strategy which is configured in the configuration file. So another point make. You can also think about the name of your database. The normal database is over here. You can see over here it's called Traits version 3 dry run because the dry run bot is enabled. But you can also give it another name, like for example with this setting. Let's change it and see what's happening then. The benefit of this is that you can actually use multiple bots at the same time on the same server and give each bot its own database name. So you can separate them from each other. Okay, let's give it the database name. Oh, did not select everything. And just put it over here. Now let's make this a little bit more nicer. Save it. And let's see what's going on when we start FragTrade again. Okay, it's running, so should be enough. And it's not over here because what I did earlier is setting the user data directory. And let's see if it's over here. Oh. Look, this is the new database. And it's also in the right directory. Let's clean this up and go to the next one. In the final demonstration of this section, I'm going to change the process throttle and add the heartbeat interval and SD notify lines to the config file. So let's open the config and go to the back. A little bit too far. You see here that the default process throttle is 5 seconds. So every 5 seconds, the process will be loaded with FragTrade, the FragTrade process. I'll set this to 1. And I'm going to add these two lines to the config file. Save it and execute the bot. Let's see what will happen now. Okay, everything looks like it's loading fine, and immediately you can see that the heartbeat is every 1 second, like I have shown over here. In the meantime, I'm going to also open my system monitor to see how heavily my CPU is used by FragTrade. And you can see here that it's 17%. Normally the CPU will be loaded at 70%, but the difference is that every 1 second, FragTrade is using my CPU. If I make this process throttle 5, 10 or 15 seconds, then every 15 seconds a FragTrade cycle will be starting and make use of my process. But at this moment, it is just constantly making use of my processor. Okay, let's get this out of the way and change some settings so you can see what will be the result if I change these settings to a lower value. For this, I have to reopen my configuration file. go to the end of my file. I'll set the heartbeat interval to 2 minutes, so that is 120 seconds. And the process throttle I will make, well, let's see, 15 seconds. And you can see then what will happen. Start the bot again. And in the meantime, I'm going to drag my system monitor in place so that we'll see what's going on. Okay, this is starting the bot. And now you can see that the fractrate process is gone, and in a couple of moments, it's now, you can see that it's just making use of the processor at a much slower pace. So if you have a system that's not as fast as this one, then it's actually better to set the process throttle to a lower frequency instead of a high one like this. And there it is again. And also you can see that the heartbeat interval is not appearing because the 2 minutes have not passed. Okay, great. That's the end of this first demonstration, and let's continue with the presentation. The settings to connect to different exchanges can be somewhat different for each exchange. The default configuration parameters as seen here are good enough to connect to the major exchanges, is my experience. However, you should always take care and check if you use the correct parameters, because if you overload the exchange with too much requests, the rate limiter can kick in and your IP address can be banned. And that would be not good for your bot, of course. Also keep in mind that Fractrate is making use of an external library for connecting to the cryptocurrency exchanges. This is the CCXT library. It's a very popular library among trading bot builders, and the GitHub page is an excellent source for information, and I definitely recommend reading that. The Fractrate developers have tested the bot on different exchanges, but not on every CCXT supported one. So it might be possible that your exchange is supported by CCXT but does not work with Fractrate. So you have to test it out and see what's happening. Let's start with the most obvious exchange settings. These are the exchange name, API key, API secret, and if needed, the exchange password. The exchange name is obviously the exchange you want to trade on with your bot. So if you want to use Binance, enter Binance over here. If you want to use Kraken or Bitfavo, then enter those names in the exchange name configuration parameter. When you want to do live trading with actual money, then you will need the API key and API secret from the exchange and store it in the key and secret sections of the config. You will have to make these for yourself in the exchange. I recommend you to keep the key and secret to yourself. Also, some exchange use passwords, and you should put the password in the exchange.password section. After you have set the information to connect to the exchange, you'll have to determine which pairs you want to trade. And before we move on, it's important to know that the default configuration file uses the volume pair list option. This option means that the bot downloads market data and checks the top 20 pairs with the most volume and trades these pairs. To make use of a static pair list with your own favorite pairs, you should change the pair list option from volume pair list to static pair list. I'll show you this in the demonstration a little bit later. So to continue with the exchange options, the pairs whitelist should only contain the specific crypto pairs you want to trade. And if you want to trade all available coins against a certain base currency, like a USD Tether or Bitcoin, you can use a wildcard like shown over here. The blacklist option is the reverse of the whitelist option. These pairs you do not want to trade. This is especially handy if you have a wildcard like Bitcoin and you want to exclude a certain pair from trading this vast range of possibilities. The exchange sandbox option can be used to test your bot and its configuration against the test version of the exchange. This comes in handy if you want to test an experimental setting or feature and you don't want to use the exchange with real money on it. Testing in combination with the log underscore response settings is advised, because then you can see what's actually going on between the bot and the exchange. This way you can also spot errors and fix them before you use the settings on your real-life trading bot. These CCXT specific config parameters are directed to certain specific CCXT exchange settings. And this time I admit I'm not an expert in these settings because I mainly use the default configuration from FragTrade. Reading through the FragTrade pages tells me that one of the main concerns for connecting to exchanges is the possibility of getting blacklisted due to too many requests to the exchange and therefore being banned because the exchange thinks you are DDoSing it. For more specific information, I recommend you to read the exchange pages on the FragTrade site. If you can give a better explanation on how to make use of these CCXT configuration parameters, please do so in the comments section. FragTrade refreshes its market information each 60 minutes. You can use this parameter if you think it's too long between updates, so you can set it on a faster pace, for example, each 30 minutes or so. I think that the bot uses this information when using the volume pair lists option, and each 60 minutes a check on volume will be done, and the bot will change the top 20 pairs traded based on this information. When you want to trade pairs, FragTrade always checks if these pairs exist on the exchange during the bot startup. This way, when you make a typo in one of the pairs, the bot will spot this and will say that this pair does not exist on the exchange and will also not trade it, of course. You can skip this check by setting the skip pair validation to true. After a start or restart of the bot checks if there are open orders on the exchange. If the exchange causes problems with this, then you can set the skip open order update to true, and then the bot will not do a check for open orders at start. The default value is false, of course. And with this last bot parameter, we will continue with the demonstration of some of these parameters. In the final demonstration of this video, I'm going to add the configuration parameters for the exchange. I don't know each and every parameter, for example, the CCXT parameter. But if somebody has a clue on where to look for, maybe he or she can give us a comment in the comment section below. Also, I'm not going to explain each and every parameter. Some things are just obvious, like a key and secret and password. But I can give you a small demonstration on what the result will be if I add wildcards like this with a blacklist, and also the result if I make a small error like this and use the skip pair validation parameter. Let's open the configuration file. And look for the exchange settings. Well, they're over here. You can see over here that Binance is already set. I'm just going to add the key and secret. It's obvious, of course, that this key and secret is not a real key and secret. Oh. Okay. And just go over here and paste it. And what we can do is use a pair whitelist like this. And this means that every USD Tether pair will be used. But also I can give it a blacklist, which says that from each and every pair, I will not use the Doge USD Tether pair in this case. So I'm going to add this one, make it a little bit nice to read. And here I'm just going to do like this. Also, keep in mind that when we want to use a pair whitelist and blacklist, then we should change the pairs list method to volume from volume pair list to static pair list. So that's also good. And let's save it and just start the bot. And let's see what's happening over here now. And as you can see, the static pair list will be used with a wildcard. So each and every USD Tether pair will be used on the exchange, except for the Doge USD Tether pair, which was in the blacklist. And you can see it removes it from the whitelist. Okay, let's end this small demonstration and move on to the next one. And in this demonstration, I'm going to add a sandbox option, lock responses, market refresh interval, actually this whole section. Jason, he's from Halloween. And we just simply copy and paste this whole section. Okay, let's check if this is correct. I think it is. Save it and exit. Okay, so what we just did is adding these lines which say that the market refresh interval should be set to 5 seconds instead of 60. The skip pair validation has been set to true. However, I did not make a typo, so it was giving me a warning. But because I did not make a typo, it actually doesn't see anything, no errors. I mean, if the exchange will give an error message, then it will skip the error messages and just continue. And everything will be working fine, I guess. Yeah, okay, well. Let's end this session with a small typo and see what will be the result of that. I'm going to open the config file once again. And instead of using a wildcard, I'm adding just two pairs. BTCD and ETH. And you can see that I made a typo over here, but that's the whole purpose, because the pair validation setting, which is true at the moment, should skip this trading pair error and just continue by trading with only this pair, because BTCD is not available on the exchange. Save it. Start. So it's starting fairly quick at this moment. And when I just go back to the earlier messages, there's an error message or a message that says that the pair validation skipping has been set. And for some reason I cannot find it, but I can show you what will happen if I set the skip pair validation parameter to false. So just stop the bot, open the configuration and set it to false. And then you will see that the bot will actually check on the exchange if this pair exists. And if not, it will give us an error message. And here you can see that it did find the pair. And I should remove this from the whitelist, otherwise it will not continue. Okay, great. I think this sums up the final demonstration of this video. And let's continue with the presentation. That's it for now. I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something from it. Thank you for watching. And please click the like button, subscribe to my channel, and click on the notification bell. You know the drill. Hopefully, I will see you next time.